It's happening. Twenty-5 seconds and nobody's here. Okay, one person's here. Inbox. Four people. Can we play some Kanye?
I'm living in that 21st century. Don't mean to it. Do it better than anybody you ever seen. Skin some haters. Let's run to it. I said you better things. One man to have all that power. The clock's ticking. I just count the hours. Stop chipping. I'm chipping off the power. The system broken, the schools closed, the prisons open. We ain't got nothing to lose, motherfucker, we rolling. Motherfucker, we rolling. With some light skin girls and some heavy rollers. And it's white man world, we the ones chosen. So good night, cool world, see you in the morning. See you in the morning. This is way too much, I need a moment. No one man should have all that power. The clock's ticking, I just count the hours. Stop tripping, I'm tripping off the power. Till then, fuck that, the world's ours. Fuck it, Chanel and the whole cast. Tell them easy said they could kiss my whole ass. More specifically, they could kiss my asshole. I'm an asshole, you niggas got tough.
Yes, I'm switching off the music and I'm saying, what kind? It's 10 p.m. It's Thursday night. That means you're here with me. It's Richelieu B on the meetup. Craig G, how you been, bruh? I've been 100%. I've been surviving. I've left the house a couple times. So I've seen the world out there. So make yourself seen. Say, make, put a comment there. Let me know that you're around. It's been a quiet week in the world. Everybody's been doing their thing. People have been out there living their lives. Comedy's back a little bit. I've been back a little bit. So I left the house like 4 times this week, which is the most I've left the house in ever. What's the chit chat about? Debbie Adams, welcome to the meetup. The chit chat is about not Man United. you know it's gonna be about Man United because we have to address the elephant in the room. No pun intended. People say no pun intended, but tell you the truth, every single pun ever has ever been is always intended. How's it saying? So yeah, it's been a bit of a week. Neil Green is officially in Ireland. He's going to do the Irish thing there. 13 people. So there's a new rule now. If you're watching and listening, you have to click share. Let everybody know. Have you performed, Craigie G? I have two or three gigs lined up for like the next 4 days. But I'm a little bit scared. You know what I mean? It's like it feels worse than the first time because you know when you first do comedy or whatever, there's no precedent, right? You don't know. Hello, Francine. Like when you first do comedy, you don't have you don't know what to expect. But I've been doing comedy long enough that I know what to expect. But I haven't done it so long that now I don't know what to expect, even though I know what should be expected. So Debbie Adams, you like my accents. I know this is the direct results of apartheid. This is what they did. They made us read books and speak the English. I have an amazing guest today. It's gonna be fun times. And Kenya's in the house. What's happening? David Adua, where are you from in Kenya, bruh? I don't know. Is it comedy in Kenya? I'm actually watching this thing called the Dangerous World of Comedy, where there's people that are living in like Iraq and Iran and these war-torn zones, Arabia, where it's hardcore, and they still find space to do comedy and entertain people. It's crazy. You should check it out. Debbie Adams is a K. I'm a KP. Does that mean from Cape Town? I thought that's a copy. So I've just been living life, right? Because like even like football, I'm gonna end up talking about football because my O's a football O that we're on today. But I don't talk about football because there's too many opinions. So David Theo says I'm gonna learn about David now. What does that mean? Is he a prince? He's either a prince or is there something going on? I actually had a special guest which I wanted to stick in here, but she seems to have disappeared. She probably got some connectivity issues. The onlineness has gone quiet. I've been online a little bit. The Kalis are gone quiet. I think everybody's getting ready to fight for their Christmas. Are we at Byron? What's happening, Machi? Click share. That's my new rule. So what's going to happen is I'm going to bring on, there's a girl that inboxed on the Radio of Color thing. She's a young lady all the way from KZN. She stays around, around the tennis course there, which is not wasteful, but they are around that section. And she's got a song, and I gave the song a listen. And the thing is, I'm a stickler for people who are on the up and who want to make space for themselves, right? So let me introduce her and then we'll play a song. I just want you guys to meet her. Ladies and gents, let's make some noise. I don't have sound effects right now, but let's make some noise for Kitty. Very dark there, Kitty. Are you hiding away? No EPL.
Yes, hello. Yes, hello, I'm Kitty. Here. How are you? Hi. Hey, I'm good, thanks. How are you? I'm very well, thank you.
Where are you from again?
KZN, Durban, Westridge, Durban.
Oh, Westridge, that's the thing. Oh yeah. So we all KZN people. And yeah. You do music. How old are you? Because I think you said you were 16. Are you?
I am 16 years old.
Okay, so you started, I mean, how long are you doing music?
Oh well, how long during COVID, you know, COVID time, so I had a lot of time during the lockdown, so yeah.
And you just started doing music recently. And then so who helped you? Who's been helping you with your music? What's your inspiration behind your music?
Well, I've been pushing on my own. I have a friend, Marco Sonke. We've been working together, and yeah, I've been pushing.
Okay, so I'm gonna play your song now. I'll leave you on while your song plays. And then what's gonna happen is that the people that are listening are gonna listen to your song and they're gonna give feedback. So are you ready for that? You know what I mean? It's the big world now.
Ooh,
so
yeah. Okay.
Let's see how it goes. I'm gonna play the song. What's the name of your track?
This song is called
I'll wait. Westridge doesn't have the best signal apparently. But so okay, she's not. She's got that circle thing. All right. So I feel bad to play this song now because if I start playing it, she's just gonna come back in the middle of the song. So we lost you. We completely lost you, right? All you heard was the name of the song. Okay, now she's gone. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna play the song. Let's listen to it, guys. Let me see if it comes up.
Keep your crown. They hated you, they still do. They hated you, they still do. But they held you down, 'cause you couldn't stand the frown. They took your ass and your clown. They colored you blue and brown with their wicked kicks and bones. With the wicked kicks and punches, you unhappy fellow, always bright, smiled and mellow. You always fancied anything yellow. that always had a race, bro. It never befriended a black crow. You escaped the grips and ran for your life, for your life. Many things race back and forth in your mind, running your fingers through your hair, through your hair. You found a bit psycho. You didn't comprehend why they envied you.
My lighting's
bad. Instantly you crumble down, put it all out. The rage, the agony, all out.
I'm gonna stop it right there. How does that feel? What do you think, ladies and gents listening in? We got 24 people listening, but it's gonna go to a lot more people. How does that feel, Kitsi? This sounds very deep for a 16-year-old, though. It sounds like you there's a lot going on, though. She's frozen, right? She's obviously not gonna hear me speaking right now. So I'm gonna say well done to you, well done to Kitsi. I like that. I think that there's people that will listen to this right now and will get into that and will speak to her, and I think something will become of it. So I'm gonna say good luck to you, Kitsi. I hope that all your dreams and your music aspirations, because this is an amazing voice. This is that Rihanna type of a vibe. This is what the future is about, right? I don't know if you can see my art here behind me. This is me teaching my boy how to color in between the lines. So well done to Kitsi. She's obviously got a bad stream. We can say I'll say goodbye to her officially. If I can get her back, I'm gonna give her 3 seconds and she's not back. Cool. So with that, I'm gonna bring my guest on for the evening. This guy, as you all know, he's actually started making a name for himself as a football pundit, which is weird. He's done a lot, he's opened, he's played with a lot of guys, he's done like comedically. I've known him for years, and like we're gonna speak about that. And he was a quiet little boy when I first met him. He's won awards. He's an award-winning comedian right now. So let's make some noise for my boy from the bottom. We got a lot in common, right? We both love Kanye. We both love sneakers. But he chose the wrong team. But we can't blame the guy, bruh. So let me play my horns. I got the horns. Let's make some noise for... Dillan Oliphant. And another buck in the house. How you doing, bro?
I'm okay, thanks. And you, bro?
I can't complain, my man. I haven't seen you in a bit. I haven't seen you. Yo, I can't even think if I've seen you for the year, bro.
I haven't seen you for the year.
It ages. Someone doesn't want us to talk Man United. How's it been for you, bro? What's been going on with you? I remember you had a gig by your house, right? You had a gig by your crib one of the times.
Yeah, I did one show. We did a show we recorded a show with the production company, myself, Soil, and Emilio Tobias. So we did a little show. We sold some tickets online. It was cool, man. It was cool. We had like 4 audience members.
I was about to say, but I mean, you can walk down the streets and you can fill your garage, bro. Like this, lights on the streets are waiting for an opportunity like that.
where I stay is like really quiet. It's like there's not really people in the street. It's not like
things are changing in the wood now.
I don't stay in El Dorado Park specifically. I stay next to El Dorado Park. We moved from next to. It's still a bit quiet this wood here, you know. It's one of those woods.
But I mean, I'm the same because we also stayed on the like we also stayed in and then we moved a little bit out, just like a little bit out. It's not like you can still hear the car spinning and you can still hear, but you just not. You can't. Debbie wants to remove the subtitles. You can't remove the subtitles. It's actually I supposed to remove the subtitles, but I also I'm not an IT guy, so. The subtitles are there. Just ignore them, Debbie. Just ignore them. It's like you have never bought one of those movies from the Pakistanis or something before. Where the subtitles, applause, laughter. So yeah. The subtitles are there. It's my form of entertainment. So those who just pulled in now, remember, this is the click share show. You click share because it's a talk show. There's no music. You want everybody here to listen to the Prachis. You might as well get the soccer thing out the way, bruh, because I'm actually happy that
I actually took a break from football. Hey, football has broken me, bruh. I'm tired of football now.
I know. What's happened to me, bruh? Like, when Liverpool, there was a point there when they started, it was just after the yellow jersey, when they started playing with Ipia and all that shit. I took a sabbatical. Yeah. I took about 3 years off. I was like, nah, bruh. I folded all my t-shirts. I don't even wear football t-shirts anymore. I was like, I don't even want people to know now.
I'll be fine for the international break. I'll be fine after the international break.
But you've been killing it though. You've been doing those football analysis type videos. And that's given you like people from overseas have started listening to you. You've got like a UK audience now. It's given you a lot of like scope, right?
Yeah, it's kind of like it's a weird thing. Like I obviously just started doing just to have fun, just because I like the internet because the internet gives you like a platform to do like whatever you like doing, whatever you want to do. That's one thing the internet has actually given us. Like there's no TV channel that would give me that'll make me talk about Man United as much as I want to talk about Man United.
Yeah.
Talk about football as much as I want to talk about it, you know.
You can't say fuck Michael Owen.
Platform. I can't say that on Super Sport. You know what I mean? So yeah, I like that the internet gave me that. And then along with that, there just came more people. People started liking it and just keeps it's just been growing, man. Those videos moving.
Because like people that want me to get rid of the subtitles, I don't know how. I'm looking at the settings over here. I don't know. Guess the comments.
You kill my father.
Yeah. I'm done. This is it. OCD is in overdrive. So Debbie, I feel like Debbie wants to be in this conversation. Like we need to put another. Debbie's making me. I feel like I'm working now. It's like there's a station manager sitting on me. Like, yo, these people that can't read that fast.
Just ignore the subtitles, Debbie. Just ignore it.
It's hard.
Not there.
It's
like when you,
it's a difficult thing to ignore the subtitles. So you've done the soccer thing, and you kind of seem to have slowed down the thing because is it just because before you were doing, did you time them or do you just do it when you feel like doing it?
I obviously I do Man United ones all the time because I'm a Man United fan first, and like so I do Man United videos all the time. I started doing other ones. They also do really well, actually. They do actually a bit more. They actually do really well, those other ones. It's just that I don't have, like, the time. You know, it's a lot of energy. It's a lot of work, those videos. I know they're only, like, 3 minutes long. Like,
yeah.
4 minutes long, but they're, like, a lot of work.
Downloading sound, pictures. You edit and all that.
Editing and all of those vibes. You know, it's, like, a lot of work. So someone wants to pay me for it. I'll do other.
You know how it goes. You have to. They pay you once they see the numbers. They pay you. It's like imagine you a sculptor, and they're like, yeah, but Where's your
yeah look, I like talking about all football, but like the ones I like the most, because those are the ones
There's a lot of haters in like hooligans, not haters, you say hooligans, right? So do you find that you get like people that are hating on you directly, specifically?
Bro, I don't know. You know, my comment section on Facebook specifically, people say the meanest things.
To you.
This guy is boring. Yeah. They say things like that, right? Yeah, this guy will stop talking. What's up with the accent?
Are those people from South Africa, or are those people like international people?
It's usually colored people, actually. That it's your own that's slandering those harsh words.
And I tell you something, I've spoken about this so many times on this exact platform, is that bro, we hate each other.
Yeah, we do hate each other. Which, like I'm telling you, the most hate I've gotten. Like, in fact, I think it's like a 2% another race. It's always a colored man. It's always a color. Even if it's not even to do with, like, because sometimes I like understand, because it's like your football team that I just slighted, and you know, it's like I can understand why you personally don't like what I said now. And maybe you want to hit me back with a personal one. I say, okay, that's fine. But now, sometimes I'm like, I'm not even talking about Man United. Then I'm getting, I'm not even talking about Liverpool. You know, it's because what I've noticed is that like a lot of the fans, the followers of those videos are also quite Liverpool, staunch Liverpool supporters. So they're always in my comment section. Hoying things. Well, we can take the trolls, you know, we take the love, Man United, a pup, and all those type of things. But
some
of them go deep, brah. Some of them go
deep.
Some say the most hurtful shit I ever heard in my life, brah. Then I'm just like, I just block. I just block, though.
Okay, so now you become that person. You're an online personality now. Another one you always talk about.
The thing is, some of the people moved. Yeah, you always talk about the Manx. Yeah, I'm always talking about Man United. That's the most, that's all I talk about, actually. And then sometimes I'll throw in. But like some of the people who's come to my videos now, they haven't seen me do stand-up comedy before. So they only know me from...
Right, from, that's a whole new...
videos, you know?
Right, that's a new audience completely.
It's like a whole new audience completely, yeah. So I don't know. Some of them don't. Some that's watching it, they don't really get it, or they don't really want to get it. So they're all like, yo, this bruh just hates my team. Because I hate every team that's not Man United, bruh. Like, literally, it's not a specific team. It's not Arsenal I hate. It's not Liverpool. I hate all of them. But if it's your turn, like... it's your turn this week, you know?
Exactly. It's like, I have this conversation with Corbin. That's why I don't like having football conversations, because you can't. It doesn't make sense. It's like, no matter what I say, like, even if you can talk statistically, like, if that guy scored 10 goals and my guy scored 15 goals, this guy can't accept that. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you talk about but this bro has been injured for the last 5 games. Yo, bro. Because I also do that. I defend my players all the time.
I can't. It's too much work.
Supporters take it the most. They take it to heart. Liverpool supporters take these things to heart.
Yeah, man, because we've been suffering for a long time. And now, finally, I was like, And you know what? It's like, and Liverpool always look like they're about to make it, and then some other shit happens, and Steven Gerrard falls down, and then you're like, ah,
no one Liverpool is. They've been trying to get a girlfriend for all these years, and when they get that girlfriend, they want the world to know, and they need to almost justify why they have this girlfriend.
Yeah.
It's like, yo, bro, just be happy with your girlfriend.
Yeah. I also find that though. I support Liverpool, but I also get irritated by Liverpool people myself. I'm like, bruh, okay, we won. I don't have to wake up. Bro, if we won the league, I don't have to wake up tomorrow morning and say, fuck Man United. You know what I mean? It's like, why? it's
such a weird, like, because my page is a lot of Man United stuff, so I post like pictures of, like, I'll post like a picture of Man United signed a new player. Then there's Liverpool supporters in that comment section dissing. I'm like, yo, guys, all I did was, good gracious, welcome my player to my team. There's no need for us. There's no need for us. But they there, bruh. This guy is so shit. I'm like, yo, just calm down. I like this guy. I'm fine with this guy. Why do you feel the need to come into my conversation?
You can't introduce me to my friends. I don't like him.
I can't be happy, bro. I can't be happy as a Man United supporter. I just can't be happy. That's what they want. They don't want to see me happy.
we're gonna talk comedy, we're gonna talk other shit, but before that I'm gonna play a song. I played Kanye at the starting because I know Dillan is one of the people in the same boat. I feel sorry for Kanye, you know what I mean? Because Kanye, I mean, he's rich and mad. That's you know what I mean? Because we only used to people
recording, man. Black. He's a crazy rich black.
We used to people walking around the hood and it's like
Asian.
Like we're used to those people that are walking around the wood and everyone's like, this thing is mad. And you're like, oh, okay, sure. But he has money. He can make it out. I'm gonna play a song. What are you in the mood for, your bruh? What do you feel like is a good Thursday night song for you, bruh? Or artist, do you wanna do Kanye or there's everything? I know you like Tamia.
I don't like Tamia, but it's also not like my thing. Alicia Keys is my thing. I like Alicia Keys.
Let me find an Alicia number. I know you. You see, that's what I'm saying. But there's so many things that is so many. Like, I'm also like Alicia, and plus you came to Wentworth. That's insane. Let me see if I can find an Alicia.
Come to Wentworth.
Absolutely, bruh. I'm gonna play one of my favorite Alicia ones, and then I can't talk because it fights for sound, but anyway, Trey, this is.
Some people live for the fortune. Some people live just for the fame. Some people live for the power, yeah. Some people live just to play the game. Some people think that the physical things define what's within, and I've been there before. That life's a bore, so full of the superficial. Some people want it all, but I don't want nothing at all. Some people need 3,000 roses, and that's the only way to prove you love them. hand me the world on a silver platter. And what good would it be? No one to share.
I feel like they mute our music. The copyright police quotes us, but it's cool. that's Alicia Keys. That's the way we move into the next topic. I want to talk comedy. You love sneakers. Let's talk sneakers for a little bit. You love sneakers. How many pairs do you have, Dillan?
I don't know how many pairs I have specifically, but I think I have like 50.
Oh, 50.
I think
it's a nice round 50, number. Yeah. And mainly Jordans. You mainly wear Jordans.
It's around 50. And I'm not too sure how many Jordans, but it's mostly Jordans. It's mostly, I think, like, I think 40 of those are like Jordans. And, I like Jordan 1s. Jordan 1s are like my favorite Jordans. Jordan 1s and Jordan 3s. And Jordan 5s, bruh.
You don't like Jordan 4?
And 4s, sorry. 4s, of course, yeah.
Yeah.
4s are beautiful.
Jordan, yeah. I got Jordan. Actually, I'm the only one in my house that doesn't have Jordan, bruh. Can you believe that? Look at this. These are... This is just laying. This, it's not, I didn't mean to have this here. This just happens to be laying next to me. It's the Jordan ones.
Yeah. Oh, snap. Yeah, these are fire.
Jordan ones. Yeah. What else is here? Jordan. What is this? The mic fell down. Oh, this is a Jordan Legacy. I know nothing about these shoes. You know that.
I see. Yeah, those ones are like the, they look a bit like the Jordan 3s.
There's a toddler pair. The toddler pair has obviously disappeared. I just wear what's around. So you got about 50 pairs. Which is your favorite one? Do you have a favorite one pair out of all those pairs there?
My favorite pair is because my favorite pair are the Yeezys, man. I love.
Which cool. Yeezy do you have?
I've got the Yeezy 350s, yeah, version 2.
Have you seen the new Yeezy?
I've got two pairs of Yeezy 350s, yeah.
What size you take?
It's a 7.
Just checking.
I've went to stand in line for Yeezy so many times, but I never won. And then one time I entered online and I won the raffle. So then
that's where you got the Yeezy from, the raffle.
I got the Yeezy from the raffle from Shelf Life. They have those raffles every other.
Yes, Stuart, there's a question for you.
Would you rather want the Jordan 1 Off-White or Jordan 1 Travis Scott? Obviously, Jordan 1 Off-White Chicago's below.
The Chicago's are red and white ones?
Yeah, but the Off-White ones are... Oh, it's the red and white, but it's just the off-white.
Oh, it's got the off-whites.
Those are like the grails, bro. Those are like, if I did get those ones, I'm done.
Yeah. Did you check that sneakerheads thing that they've been, that's on Netflix at the moment?
Yeah, I watched that series, actually. I like the sneakers more than I like the series itself.
The story was weird, right?
The story was like, yo, this is a grown ass man who is leaving his wife too. Maybe I don't understand.
And he's making terrible decisions, bruh. And he's making
horrible decisions, bruh. Horrible, with no insight, no nothing. Just like based on a hope. He's making decisions like a football fan, bruh. Just betting that your team can win when you know your team can't win. That's exactly how.
You know when I knew the decisions were terrible? It was like when they bought a locker, and in this locker there was one shoe of every pair or whatever. But they didn't check the other stuff. There was like rims in there and other clothes. I'm like, he didn't even try and recoup some of his investment. Then I was like, nah, these guys are making.
It's also like yellow weird, like how when they buy the sneakers or when they get the sneakers from other dude, they don't check in the box, bro. They just
walk away.
I'm like, I would never spend such big guas to just take a box and just leave, bro. No. I actually want to be there, put it on to see if that is the thing, bro. I cannot just take sneaker box and accept it.
I promise you, the main part of a sneaker too, you have to open it and get that, that smell.
Yeah, like, right. You have to be in there, right? You have to feel it. They are sneakerheads, so I can't think that the sneakerhead would just take a box and leave. I can't see it, bro.
Yeah,
but the sneakers in there were fire, though.
Yeah, there are some dope sneakers in there.
There's some dope sneakers.
Bro. I know it's a disease that we both have. Debbie, I do like brandy, but most importantly, I always used Richelieu because that's my name. That's my Christian name. That's what I was baptized as and confirmed. For those of you who don't know, I was confirmed. They dipped me in the rivers. Let's talk comedy, bro. I remember meeting you. I remember you got into comedy through a very strange route, right? You came into comedy through competition, right? Was that your first time doing comedy?
First time doing comedy, but a month before that I started doing comedy.
Tell us about your first time, bro.
My first time doing comedy, I did at Parker's Comedy Club. I did an open spot there at Parker's Comedy Club. I remember I did five, Parker's open spots, so you do your 5 minutes, 5 to 7 right. minutes, but I did 3 minutes in my first open spot, and then I clocked out. I left the stage. I froze and they clapped me off. I got clapped off.
Leave them wanting more.
In fact, for that 3 minutes, I was doing well, bruh. I was like, you'll shoot how well I was doing for that 3 minutes. And then I forgot the rest of my... Because I prepared a set. I don't know. Prepared a set for my first open spot.
And that time, and then, when you started doing comedy, you're doing stagnant one-liners, right? Because now you kind of... you still do one liner, but you kind of storied your one liners, right? Before you were
when I started, I was really one liner. No one but my first open spot, I did that, and then after that, I went to Kiriboni Mula Utsere gig there at Ozone.
Oh yeah,
and then that was the only other gig I knew. I knew Parker's did open spots, but I also knew that Parker's is very far. And Ozone is very close to where I stay. It's 10 minutes away, 7-10 minutes away, you know. And then Wednesdays, the Wednesdays before the competition, I went to Ozone. And I just went and I tried out some things there. And then I didn't have a style I didn't have a style at that time. I was just trying, I was being an open spot,
all
over the place.
I've been asking all the dudes this question is what was your inspiration? How did you get in? Was it early on in your life? You wanted to be funny or what inspired you eventually to this is what I want to do. Let me get on stage. Because it's a big thing. Cause you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's nerve-wracking, bro. So what
did you want? Know what happened? In church, I used to be part of the youth there, and part of the youth, I would love plays, bro. Yeah, I love plays. When it's time to do plays, I'm the guy who wants to do plays, bruh. I'm the guy. I started writing plays even. I started doing plays that I write. So I would write little short plays, and I do. And then I was like, I get frustrated because no one's as interested as I am. These are the youths, man. They're just there for the fun times, you know. And I was like, this is irritating. I want to do something where I don't have to rely on anybody. And then stand-up comedy came along, you know.
Okay, and then what did you discover? Were you watching Pure Manati show? Were you listening to comedy?
I watched Chris Rock, man. I remember I used to watch Chris Rock
religiously.
Chris Rock and Russell Peters. Right. Russell Peters got to watch. Somebody going to get hurt real bad. That gag, bro. That gag used to kill me all the time, bro. I used to show that gag to all my friends.
Russell Peters used to kill me with when he asked the dude what he's doing improv, and he says, "Okay, what's your name?" And then I was like, "My name is Jatesh, Batish or something." And he started going on about how it sounds like a bomb went off, the whole world went Batish. For me, that was Kabul, Kabul or something like that. And for me, when I saw him doing that, I was like, "Yo, this old just took his name and he put it into so
many. And he made a joke, yeah. You know, yes, joke. So
and I liked him for a long time. And also Chris Rock as well. I loved watching Chris Rock, bro.
Cat Williams, bro. Cat Williams. Those are the Chronicles. I used to check that out.
Yeah, those are the dudes that make you think that, okay, this looks like you can do it. Like, they taking scenarios, like scenes from their lives, like they end up making it seem like something that is funny, and you like, and it makes you think that you can, you want to be a part of it. And that's how I felt about watching them, right? And then you did open spots at Parkers, and then you, how long have you been performing? A month.
Yeah, and then it's crazy. Like, and then I won that Nando's competition. Yeah. That's what happened with the Nando's comedy competition, right? I just went to, no one knew me backstage. And I remember Tets was backstage, Tets and Konzo, Dusty Rich was there, Deep Fried Man, like, oh, Rabin, there was like really good comedian. I remember that top 10 was like Red Tips was there. There was like really good comedians in that final. Yes, I remember.
Yes.
And then I didn't know them either. I didn't know them. So no one knew me. And then I drew my name and I was like, you're first. I was barely a comic that time. You know what I mean? It's like, you're first, bro. What the hell? You know, I even asked some other guys, can we not swap? No one wanted to swap, obviously. Why would they want to swap? I went on first. That's when someone told me I have a style, bro. I didn't know about styles and things. I just went to the stage and I just stood there and I did my jokes that I prepared for like this last month. And those were the only jokes I had. So I just did those jokes that I prepared for the last month, bro.
Because I was there. I think I was there. It was over two nights. You did two nights, right?
It was one night.
It was one night. Okay, so
it was two nights. Yeah, sorry, two nights. It was a. There was a to get into the final, and
the
then
there was one, yeah. So yeah, I saw you at the one before the second to last one. I think I met you just like around that time, I think. And then I saw you at Parker's, and then I saw you doing that thing, and I was like, no, this guy, because you had a vibe, right? Like everything was. It is hard to, you know, because the thing is, when you see a comedian, you look at how they perform and you listen to what they're saying, and you can kind of think that you know what they are, who they are, or where they come from, and that type of thing. You know what I mean? Like if you watch Robbie, you can think of, okay, you can kind of figure him out, like his person. Yeah. For you, you're like, yo, I don't know what's like, I don't know what.
A lot of guys told me, oh, they thought I'm gonna die. They thought I would have sucked, bro. Like,
yeah.
But like, I was, when I started comedy, I think even now, I'm still an introvert, but like, I was like really introvert.
Yeah. You are like, comedy,
I was like really, yeah. Like very like shy it. And timid and like, you know? So then, so that's how that style actually helped me defend the nerves, you know, fight the nerves. I think that style I just used it as a thing to help me fight the nerves and not be as anxious and nervous. And I went on stage that night also. That was the first time I actually did it like that. I did stand up like that. I just stood there and spoke like that. And it worked proper. And so then David Tabuka came to me after the show. He's like, yo, I like your style. I was like, oh, snap, I got a style. My life is, I have caught the stick down. I already got a style and things. Yeah, this loves me. David Tabuka was like crazy impressed. David Tabuka was crazy, crazy impressed. And I was like, this is the guy I saw on that Just Because comedy. DVD, because that's also one of the DVDs I used to watch like a lot before I started. I used to watch it, but I used to watch it because I knew every joke on that DVD, bro. That was one of my favorite comedy DVDs ever. That's Just Because comedy, because they had like Cajizo Letija, it had Luis Ocola, it had David Kibuka. And that Trevor Noah on that one. Yeah, I was like,
DVD.
And I went to check that show out live also before.
Yeah, so, and they're all dressed and tidy in that thing, bro. Do you remember how they were dressed?
Yeah. Imagine he was wearing a Chelsea jacket. Why? I'm going to still talk to him about it. Like, so Gola was wearing a Chelsea jacket. I'm going to talk to him about it. I need to get a DVD. I'm sure it must be somewhere in the house. I'm going to see.
Yeah, probably like, was. Yeah,
is this you? Next time he tweets something about Arsenal, I'll be like, is this you?
Yeah.
It's going to be overway.
Find it. Must be on YouTube somewhere.
Yeah, it must be somewhere, bro.
I remember, so you won that thing, and then you played the Nando's Festival, which was at the Teatro, right?
Yeah, bro. It was like insane for me. It was like, bro, I just started comedy like a month ago. I didn't expect to be performing to over a thousand people, but I was. Oh, that was crazy for me. And then like 2 days later, because Joe Paco was also in the audience that night when I did the Nando's comedy in the Teatro.
Okay.
So then I did well there that night also. That was one of the easiest rooms I've ever played, actually. The Teatro was actually one of the easiest rooms. It was like there was a sold out audience, the people came for International Comedy Festival. And I was just there. I had my few gigs that I did.
Yeah, your 9 minutes.
At the final. my 9 minutes. I had those gigs ready to go. Then I did that. And then Joe Parker just gave me a shop after. I was like, yes, Joe Parker likes me. I got like 2 days later, I got like a message. Someone asked me, it's like, yo, would you like to do Blues Room? I'm like, who's this? I even messaged her like, who's this? What are you talking about, bro? I was like, and then it's like, no, it's David Kibuka. I was like, okay,
yeah.
I'll do that. Then yeah, I went through the Blues Room with my parents, bro. I used to roll with my parents for a long time.
But that's dope, bro. Nobody can say that. Because remember, that was also my intro. When I came here, I played the underground, and Kibuka came up. Same thing. He came to me, and he's like, "All right, cool." Because I met him at Blues Room, right? I went with Robbie, and then when I was meeting him, he's like, "No, no, no. I don't meet any more comics. Just get away from me." That type of vibe. And I was like, oh, okay.
And then Kibuka was like a snob.
Yo, bro.
I mean, real boss.
Then on the Sunday, I play at the underground. Then as soon as I walked off, he came in. He's like, okay, I never came here to see you, but I saw you. And he gave me like two things, change this and change that. I was like, okay, cool. And then Tuesday, come to the Blues Room. Then I was like, oh, okay, yo, but that, you know, it feels like, oh, no, Nando's room, playing to 1,000 people was probably less nerving than playing the Blues room.
I was like, yo, I'm going on after. I went on after Trevor the first time I went there, bro. I don't know why Trevor was opening the show, and I'm like, yo, why am I going on after this guy?
Nobody knows that Trevor, right? The swearing Trevor and talking about,
although I think I came across Trevor when he was a sweet Trevor. When I came across Trevor, he already made the transition.
If I seen him in Blues Room, I'd be like, what? This is the guy that does the daywalk? No.
Yeah, I've never seen him do the swear Trevor. Like, I've never ever seen Trevor swear and stuff.
And so you... Okay, so like I want to talk about. So like you became I think you are one of the quickest, wittiest roast guys that we have, right? But I'm always disappointed that I didn't meet up with you in the final of the roast battle, bro. Like that's like up until now. It's always a thing that I always feel like, hey, bro, I just want
my last game floundered there. What is this? And then the roast battle. My last game.
I was disappointed. You know, the thing is, like, even now, I have it on the PVR day. They re-edited it now, so they made it all different. They chopped it up weirdly. So, like, it's very weird. But every time I watch it, bro, and it's like, you know, when you watch the football highlights and your team lost 2-1. And in the last minute, and you watch the highlights, and you still hope that doesn't score.
Things have changed, yeah.
Like every time I watch that thing, bro, I see that, and I check you, and you burn Ayanda, and then after you burn Ayanda,
yeah, I saw Ayanda there.
You broke her, and then your foot didn't work, And then they're like, "Ah, you're gonna verse Mark Banks," and I was like, "No, bruh." I was upset, man, because I was like, in my mind, I'm like, "Okay, Dillan's like the main guy of the roasting." I came in as an underdog because no one expects me to come. But in my mind, I was like, "Nah, bruh, I'm not the underdog. I know what's going on here." And when you went out, I was like, "Bruh, I had not a single bit." For Mark Banks, not even for I probably wrote.
you were waiting for me.
I said, for you, I wasn't even sleeping. I was waking up in the middle of the night.
I didn't think, to be honest with you, like, because I went up against Tabiso, and then people were telling me, like, how Tabiso is like, it's like how well he did with the last one, right? And I mustn't, like, he distract you and stuff, right? But like my style, even at the roast, I was even like very like, I'll do my joke and then just let it be, bruh. Like completely not care what you. So you know, my energy is so low that you can't feed off it. I'm smart. It's a tactic that I almost use. I'm like, you can't feed off my energy, so you just there. Bro. So whatever you say, I'm just waiting for you to say your next joke, bro.
You obviously watch the thing. That's exactly what I was doing the same, right? It's like, I didn't, not one rebuttal. I did the whole roast. I didn't do one rebuttal, bro, the whole time. I'm like, okay, but your granny, I just kept quiet the whole time.
Yeah, because once you must be able to know that this is going to win if you go for a young rebuttal. Because if it stinks, it almost takes all of it, yeah. So Tabiso tried to do that. I was like, bro, you're not gonna do that with me. I'm gonna let you do it. Your gags better be strong. If your gags are not strong, we're not gonna do
that. That's over. For me, I think, man. Yeah, because I was like, hey, bro, Mark Banks. Now I just look like I was homophobic because all of the things, like, let me see what's going on. Let me talk about how old he is. Yo, and now when I watch it, I cringe, bro. I'm like, I hope my lights are on one day. And be like, yeah, my pali was homophobic. It looks really bad.
Did you do the roast after that?
The second one? No, I didn't do the second one.
Yeah.
I didn't do the second one because the way they came out, bro, the roast battle was like, I think, the Thursday in Melrose, right? And they phoned me, I think it was the Tuesday before that, the week of or the week before. They gave me like less than a week, bruh. And then first I accepted. I was like, okay, cool, sharp. And then as soon as I put the phone down, I chilled for like 5 minutes. And I was like, no, bruh, no. I want the previous one. This thing is planned. You know what I mean? This production, there's writing. You know that I wrote for the... I don't even know this, bruh. I wrote for the roast battle, right? So remember they were getting... Their material was getting written. So the people are sending in their material and they were editing the material. Yeah. I was editing the material for the other rounds. So I was sitting in the office there. The material coming in, I was looking at it. So I'm like, okay, sharp. This is good. That's bad. Let it go. Let it in and out, right? And then now I know that process is happening. So when the second one happens, they phone me with like 7 days to go. I'm like, nah, bro, this is never... Like my writing process takes longer than that because I tell you, I wrote for it. I just wrote bits. You're so fat, you're so tall, you're so thin, you're so thin, you're so poor, you're so rich. So I did generics. So once, this was my style. So I wrote until all the generics were done, right? And then once all the generics were done, it gave me more strength in my mind to write further. Do you know what I mean? So then I could focus on you. I can be like, I'm not gonna say you're tall. I'm not gonna say you're fat or you're dark or you're so thin or you're like, I'm not gonna say that because I've already flexed that part of my mind out and now I can go deeper into material. Then I'm like, I can't do that in this week. I literally won't sleep. And then I was like, I phoned him back and told him I'm not coming. And they were upset, bruh. And I said, I ended up writing for Robbie, bruh. And Robbie was like in the semi. And then, Dillan, you know, I think that Mojack beats him with the hand, but all those bits, but I did those bits in the first one anyway. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can see the material.
Yeah, they asked me too. I was just like, no, I don't want to do it.
Yeah, I was happy because I wanted to. That was my only thing. I was like, nah, bro.
I was like, I'm out now.
Yeah, me too. Because you were
if you don't get me for a roast, If you don't get me for the roast, I don't want to be those roast.
Yeah. You were the one with Jeff Ross, and you won a big pot. Did you win a? You won like a
point. Yeah, right. That pot is still there in the lovely room there.
Do you use it? Have you started?
That's actually a beautiful award, that one. I like it.
Is it a real pointy nice pot?
So it looks good. The glove doesn't look as good anymore.
But the glove looks terrible. But let me tell you, it also looks good. I show this at every time I get an opportunity. I always show this.
Oh, the check.
Not even a check. It's a.
No. Yeah. The ticket. Yeah, the ticket.
You know where the ticket gets you?
To New York.
No, it doesn't. It's too big. When I go to the airport, they always say, no.
It's good now for COVID.
So you did the roasting, and then you won, and so like you've done now. You don't want to roast now. You because like I want us to be like oh, because I that's the thing I love the most. Like in comedy, I love the roast battle format. I just love the insults. Do you know what I mean? I just like that.
Yeah.
I like that. I like what it does. Like Tabiso, I'll be honest, he was dope, bruh. Like when I watched it, when I was watching Tabs, I was laughing the whole time watching it because of the way he was being, you know what I mean? Like just his whole personality.
Yeah. I didn't see it, but I heard it, but I was like, yo, I'm going up against Tabiso. People were telling me, but I was so dope at his.
Like, he wasn't punchy. Was I telling you what? He was funny. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? He was funny. He wasn't like really insulting. He was just really funny. how are we getting out of? We're getting out of the COVID now. We're getting back to the world. Are you gonna perform anytime soon? Do you wanna perform?
Oh yeah, for sure. I'm definitely gonna perform anytime soon. I'm planning. I don't have any bookings. Yeah. If you want to book me, please hook me up there with a booking. but I'm planning some of my own shows. I'm gonna do Cape Town and Durban and hopefully PE and Kimberley. Do my own one man shows, you know.
I tell you one thing, Durban love you, my man. You
really, they didn't show the love the last time I was there, so I was like, but it was a while ago. They're like 2 years ago.
No, but when you go with me, man. Oh, yes. So when you go with me, it's like, I actually hate that I can't take you. Do you know what I mean? Because I can't flood like everybody's like you know the kind of people are. every time. At the bad sense, you must just tell one joke twice, not even the same joke, just like a similar prep, like a similar.
they don't go with it.
Yeah, bruh. You know, they start saying, he thinks we are cake.
Yeah. So you can't do. But people don't understand. But I've noticed audience members or people, they just don't understand. They're like, you know, we need new jokes, just new jokes out of
like get some people. Yeah. But the people from Durban, colored people especially, they got no time. They'll get pissed off. And the thing is, because I run the show now, I've become now, I'm their complaints department.
You're the guy that they complain to,
Like, if I could mention names now, bro, you'll have no lineup. I love you in Durban. So, I guess, I'll be honest with you, I have dates in Durban for December. I don't know if it's going to happen, but if it does happen, we can probably roll together. You know, I like working at Ozora Easy. Do you know what I mean? You know what? Yeah. I want roast people backstage. I want to sleep in a bed with a sea view and an echo. Bro. And I've had those guys, bro. when you get to the place, like,
really? I don't know any comics that are.
Because you haven't taken a comic out of his home bed and put him into another bed.
Yeah, I didn't book him like that. No, I just booked
you. Put someone in another bed. Bro, the Oscar. This is not 400 count.
Where's the sheets of Egyptian cotton?
Well, the thing is, why not ask you to buy them tops, though?
Oh yeah, you're the bar.
You're the babysitter. Sorry.
You must take them out for a day.
Yeah, you must take them to the light. You must take them sightseeing. So the people that are listening, you have no excuse to come to Cape Town. Oh, Liam, yeah, but I'm in Cape Town every year. For the last 2 years, this is I'm in Cape Town this week. This is the first time I'm not in Cape Town for my birthday week, which is weird because I don't know why I end up in Cape Town, but it just happens that way. But now I'm going to be at home. Yay!
I must admit, Cape Town is like my favorite place to perform at. Yeah. Like, I don't mind.
Actually, we must have to go together because I go there by myself. Like, everybody rotates. Like when I went to Carvin, it was dope because we kind of did the show together, stayed together, we felt out the land. It was pretty dope. So after this is DJ Sanks. For those who are tuning in, this is Dillan Oliphant, one of my favorite bras. He's a very easygoing, very funny guy, ladies and gents. Let me play. Now that I got the horn, I can play the horn one more time in his praise, like a praise and worship singer. Is it yeah? So I'll see you on the circuit. Ladies and gents, thanks for hanging out. I share this thing on YouTube if you don't catch it here. And I'll see you all next week, Thursday. Peace away. After this is DJ Sanks. Salutas.
Away.
Oh,